Before we dive into this video, I have to say that I shot quite a lot of the trip before planning the story behind it. Aimlessly shooting, shall we say. All I knew is that I wanted to go to the Alps and go and find some big twisty roads. I had a vague idea of where I wanted to go, but as you're about to see, that didn't quite go to plan. The result is quite simply a very long vlog about a photographer armed with a camera, riding on some tarmac, in some mountains, somewhere in Europe. It's as much about the experience as the bike, and I've really started to figure out the Street Triple RS. I didn't think I could love this bike more than I already did, but it turns out I really can. Perhaps the overall experience sugarcoats it a little, but there's no denying that the RS is a seriously good bike. I've never ridden alone outside of the UK, so this was the first time I've luggaged up by myself. I've seen my old best mate Glenn twice in the last 8 years, so this was the perfect excuse to hook up and have some fun. What resulted is some memories that will stay with me for a very, very long time. Sorry for the intro, but I just thought I'd let you know. So only a short stint this morning, and I'm already at my destination for today, really, on the bike at least, which is this place, just outside Northampton, bike shuttle. What's going to happen, well, what's already happened is the bike's been loaded onto the big lorry behind me. I now get to go have a pint in the pub, get a bus down to Luton, provided by the bike shuttle, grab a flight and get a hotel in Geneva. And the glory of this is I haven't got to do 800 miles and wear myself out just trying to get to Geneva, let alone riding through the Alps. And also all my kit that's on my bike, so all my video kit, my clothes, the lot, it's all on the bike, including my leathers, helmet and gloves. They're all in a secure safety box, which all goes on that lorry as well. So all I need to take is my toothbrush, ready for the morning, which is perfect. So yeah, next time I see my bike is in Geneva, which is pretty awesome. Ready to rock and take on the Alps. Quick as that, my bike's here. What is it? It's 8:10 in the morning. We set off, well, we flew at 6 o'clock last night. I maybe set off from my house, I don't know, around about 9:30 in the morning. So less than 24 hours. I'm in Geneva, well rested, ready for basically an awesome day of riding and planning my routes through the Alps. My bike's here, nice and safe. My kit's in the boxes over there. The boys are just getting set up, and a sterling job. They've driven through the night, and they're still working hard now, sorting out all the kit. So yeah, absolutely awesome service. So the plan now is to head down to Chamonix, or near Chamonix, and then meet my mate, have a quick catch up, and get planning ready for eating up some miles. So basically, we woke up this morning, and the plan that we kind of made had turned to shit. The rain's come in, and the whole point of coming here was to go and ride some epic roads. Now, they might be epic, but not when they're wet. I'm not gonna get what I want out of it. So instead of going, yes, beans, always gotta get the beans. So rather than going to Switzerland, we are now, I think we're going into Italy and then back out of Italy today, aren't we? Back into France.
No, we're going through Switzerland and then into Italy.
Oh, okay, we're going through Switzerland into Italy and then staying in Italy. But we found some roads.
Three countries.
Yeah, we've found some roads on Google Maps. So that we hope, it's risky, but that I hope are going to be pretty good. I can't find anything about them on Google or anything. So yeah, it's a dead end as well. But so we're going to go up. Look at a dam this morning. What's the name of the dam?
Emerson.
Emerson Dam.
And then the
get a coffee.
And then Triomphe.
Yeah, then we're going to go on some roads and find our end destination. Then tonight we're going to camp, which is why we're getting supplies. Wake up in the morning and see where the road takes us. We've got a few ideas where we want to go tomorrow as well, camp again. But we're kind of chasing our tail a little bit with the weather. So that will kind of dictate a little bit of where we end up. Focus. So I'll start this again. Quick update, it is 7 p.m. almost, and we still haven't quite made it to our location. We probably under anticipated how long it would A, take to get here, and B, how long it would take to set off this morning, so we were late setting off. But one interesting thing about that is we've been up and down some mountain roads today, doing some video and photo shoots and stuff, as well as a lot of motorway miles. And that's just done 210 miles on one tank, which I thought was pretty amazing. At one point it was averaging over 72 miles on the dash. We've just pulled into this fuel station fueled up, and it was saying 70.5, I think it was, miles per gallon. So, you know, I know they're not perfectly accurate, but that's still pretty good going, especially when we've been sat at, you know, a good pace on the motorway for the last 110-120k. So, and what we've done is we've actually come out of the Alps now. I don't know if you can see them over here, but yeah, it's just starting to rain now. I thought we'd got away with it, but actually, I mean, you probably can't even see it because there's that much cloud behind. So we're coming into Italy now, quite far into Italy. We're now going back into the Alps to try and find this road and then set up camp. Should be interesting, but first we are heading for a coffee. About 40 minutes ago, I was at a petrol station, it was 28 degrees.
So right about now, the wind and rain take over and the camera and microphone start crying for mercy. I'm sure I start rambling about how amazing the road was, even in the rain. But to be honest, I was cold, tired and a tad wet, and really debating whether I should just turn around and look for a hotel. But in the spirit of aimlessly searching for the end of this road, we pushed on before the lightning came and we set up camp. But oh boy, were we rewarded for this in the morning with the most spectacular views for a breakfast of champions. It was an opportunity to go and have some real fun on empty, dry, twisty roads. This was fairly short-lived before a weather front forced us to take some refuge and sip on some fine Italian coffee and discuss the route and who was colder.
We're at the end of it. This road, I've got a bit of a cold, sorry. This road this is it. This is the end of the line. It literally is a road to nowhere. kind of baffling, really. Oh, I'm not going to be able to get that round now. Oh. So last night we camped. Come on, little legs. Come on, little legs. Oh, the joys of being short. Bounce off that rock. There we go. So we came up last night and the weather was absolutely atrocious. I did do a video, but it was that windy. And the rain was that bad that you couldn't actually hear what I was saying. So Nivelé Pass, very famous road. Although I don't think it's anywhere near as ridden as roads like Stelvio, Grand Saint Bernard, which I actually rode earlier, yesterday. I mean, look at this. So this is the start. You can see there's a lot of potholes. It's pretty rubbish surface. But absolutely stunning. And we are actually on the snow line, so there is snow at the same level as us. So you can see how cold it is. I mean, it reckons it's 10 degrees right now, but I can tell you that's probably quite optimistic. Yeah, but at the top here, we've just had a nice little coffee. This is like a refuge area. It reckons there's a restaurant. Don't know how good it is. I don't think it's Michelin star somehow, but there it is. And yeah, so we're going to go and do the descent of Nivelé Pass, and really, fingers crossed, the weather holds out, because about 10 minutes ago, about an hour ago actually, we came up from our camp spot and it was pretty horrific. So I've had to already dry my clothes out after 4 miles this morning. Oh, the joys. But what I want to show, there's another refuge area up there as well. But this, I mean, look at that. That is absolutely beautiful. It's epic. This road, I found it on Google Maps. I didn't even know it existed. And I was looking for some roads to ride, trying to dodge the weather, because I was going to go to Stelvio. No, I wasn't. That's ridiculous. I wasn't going to go to Stelvio. I was going to go to Furka Pass in Switzerland, and then St. Gotthard's. And instead, I came here because the weather was apparently better, and I found it on Google Maps, and it was just turn after turn after turn. Unbelievable. And when we got here, I actually didn't realise how high it was. Right now, we're just climbing up to the peak, which is just over 2,600 metres. But can you see? That is just amazing. Absolutely amazing road to ride, and it just gets better from here. It really, really does. That's where we've just come from, so we've already done a big climb. We'll keep going up. I should have a cheeky little photographer waiting for me up here. There he is. Give him a wave. Oh, the joys of knowing friends abroad. Glenn, that's Glenn, my old schoolmate. Best mates at school, used to get up to all sorts of mischief. And I haven't seen him for like 7 years. Well, he came to my wedding 2 years ago, but I haven't hung out with him for 7 years. So this is the bit that I kind of really wanted to point out to people, that you have to come here, because, don't go off the edge there, Joe, look at that. That is epic. So we're about to descend from 2,600 metres. We're not going to do it too quickly because it's rained this morning. The roads have dried again. My visor's misting up. yeah, it rained this morning. These roads are actually pretty greasy this morning. But before it rained, they were really grippy. But we can have a bit of fun. So here we are, hairpins. Yeah. I've got my waterproofs on, but I've got my leathers on underneath. Woohoo! Still wet. Yeah, still wet. This Triumph is just awesome. And actually, up here, it's really underpowered. It's lost a lot of its grunt up here. It's almost asthmatic. Which is interesting, because I didn't think it'd affect bikes as much as what it has. Let's just have another quick cheeky peek. Oh yeah, so this road goes down here, and then, yeah, you can see, there's a dam there that we ride across, beautiful lakes, and it just keeps going down. Bloody visor. I've got a pin lock in it, but I may as well put an iron in it, and with steam function engaged. So that's a bit rough there, a bit sketch. Cars, they do love to take up a lot of the road, so that's always interesting and fun. But yeah, you can see the road's actually pretty greasy, it's still wet. But it's just view after view after view. And the amazing thing about this is it, as I've shown you, it goes nowhere. So we came through some towns, which we're going to go through later, and there's like cars and buildings and bars and restaurants and hotels, but there's no one, there's loads of cars, but there's no people, no lights on. We came through it last night, there was just, it was like a ghost town, it was almost apocalypse with the weather as well. It was actually pretty freaky. So I've only actually ridden this a couple of times, I have no idea where I'm going. I am really, really happy that I put these Diablo Rosso 3s on the bike, and they have been incredible. So much more grip than I thought. Last night, I really wish I put the GoPro on, because we were tanking up this mountain. Tanking up, my mate was in the car, and he was having a bit of fun, and I was trying to keep up, but the tyres just stuck like, oh, pretty much like shit, to be fair. To a shovel. They just did not let go, and they really have actually got quite a lot of feedback. With the SPs, you had to get some temperature into them, and I had quite a few moments on them. It was quite scary. But also, this obviously is really good for the gravel and a bit more tread, so you can disperse the water a bit more. I really, really don't want to crash here, because that would be a pretty shit day. This poor tyre, these poor brakes. Don't actually know where the road goes, so I'll just slow down there before I ping myself into f***ing oblivion. Oh, this road. This road, this bike, this has got to be one of the best bikes to do this on.
One thing to point out was that we found this road on Google Maps. On the maps, its official name is Strada Provinciale 50, not the Nivolé Pass or Col de Nivolé. So when we googled the road, originally we found nothing about it. It was only when we actually got there we realised what this road was. We felt a bit stupid, but who cares, because as you can see, it's an amazing place. It probably comes as no surprise that I shot hours and hours of onboard footage, with me droning on about how amazing the roads were and how much fun the bike was. But I think you can see why I was taken back by this beautiful landscape and the fact that the road really does lead to nowhere. Sure, it had rained in places and the road was still wet, in others dry and incredibly greasy, but that didn't stop me from having a blast. However, both Glenn and I agreed that with the forecast on day 2 being incredibly stormy yet again, it would be better to head back towards his home in France and ride a few roads there. One road in particular being the Col de Jupin. Famous for its use in the Tour de France, it's like a miniature Nivolé, At the top, there's more spectacular views with a snow-capped Mont Blanc mountain in the distance. Yet another stunning road to ride along with Grand St. Bernard and all the others.
So it's day six of my Alpine adventure and unfortunately, it's time to go home. So the bike's loaded back up. I'm fueled up and ready to go. It's about 500 miles to Calais, I think. Hop on the Eurostar and then head home. So all in all, it'll be about 12, 13 hours in the saddle from this moment on. It's actually 10 to 11 in the morning. I'm an hour late leaving, which isn't exactly a good start. The weather's coming in, but who cares? It's beautiful. And I'm a little bit sad to leave this place, to be fair. So, finally made it back to Blighty. Oh, hello, Mr. Siegel. Look at the size of him. Just got back into the UK. Just stopped, fueled up. That's my fourth fuel stop over 500 and something miles, I will tell you. But yeah, it's getting late now. Just going down. That was pretty intense. That was 548 miles in one solid stint. No coffee breaks or anything like that. And just stopping for fuel and then carrying on. Took quite a few hours. Had to get my waterproofs because of the weather, etc., etc. I'm feeling a bit tired now, actually. So I'm just having a quick power snack, and then I'm going to launch up home. Another 150 miles to go. There or thereabouts, and I'll be home. The bike's been pretty flawless, and the worst thing is the wind blast. That's it. So if you can get a big screen for it, you should be fine using this for, you know, doing big distance. I actually feel pretty good. It's just the neck. At normal cruising speed, 75-80, that's spot on. Anything above that, it starts to hurt and you start to get buffeted around. But yeah, absolutely love it. Awesome piece of kit. It's been so much fun. So I'm just going to gather my thoughts and probably check in either when I get home or when I've had a nap and a few hours sleep. But yeah, absolutely loved it.
What's impressed me most about the Street Triple 765 RS on this near 2,000 mile trip is the realisation that at no point did I wish I was on any other bike. Even the motorway miles in the rain weren't anywhere near as horrendous as expected. Sure, a big tourer with a screen and heated grips would have been perfect for that bit, but I would definitely have been wishing for another bike when I'd gotten some of the Alpine roads. At altitude, the RS did lose some of its punch, but then so did I. The Rosso 3s were a brilliant tyre choice, and even after a hard day on the motorway, the rear shows no signs of squaring off. The bike simply felt like it was on rails for the whole trip, even when we took a couple of hours out to capture some leery pictures. The RS was just so manageable. Nothing feels rushed, it never gets away from you, it stops on a dime and accelerates with the noise of a symphonic orchestra. I've had an issue with gear changes engaging properly from first to second when accelerating hard, but an adjustment to the gear lever seems to have resolved that for now. I really, genuinely am struggling to find faults with this bike. It's had some little niggles, sure, with the vibing mirrors, clutch cable adjustment, and blown headlight bulbs. But that's about where the list ends. The styling divides opinion, but the design is ergonomically pleasing and the seat really is a nice place to be. The dash is incredibly easy to read and customizable with several different display layouts. The modes are there to play with if that's your thing, and the fly-by-wire and fueling is silky smooth. I just can't wait to get planning my next trip on this thing. Although perhaps next time, I'll take some waterproof gloves with me. It was awesome to catch up with my mate Glenn, and he did a sterling job of capturing some moments on the camera. Who knows, I might even let him come again next time.